Friends, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this Sunday morning as we gather together to hear the Word of God, to recount His wondrous deeds, and to encounter Him in the sacrament. It's a joy and a blessing to be together, and as we come forward for Holy Communion, all baptized Christians believing Christ's presence in the sacrament are more than welcome to commune. And so friends, as we begin our worship together this day, I would invite you now to rise for confession and absolution, as is found in the green canvas. We are here gathered in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the aid of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
And friends, let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and in the presence of one another. We pray together.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, our God forgives us all our sin. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all of your sin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Friends, at this time I invite you to join in the singing of our gathering hymn, hymn number 645 in the red hymns.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, and for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
You shepherd your people, faithfully feeding and protecting us. Heal each of us and make us a whole people, that we may embody the justice and peace of your Son. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Friends, please be seated.
A reading from Jeremiah. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people, it is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold. And they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is his name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from Ephesians. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ, for he is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Mark, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, They came to land at Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was and wherever he went into villages or cities or farms, and laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Friends, good morning.
Good morning.
Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus. Amen. I must confess to you that every now and then, when I find a show that I really enjoy watching, I will start finding time to watch it in the evenings after Hope has gone to bed and before I fully settle down for the night. I admit that I enjoy these times to wrap up a day. The quiet mindlessness of watching a show can be quite nice after a full and hectic day. But I must also admit that when the show is one that is particularly gripping and engaging, I just want to keep seeing how things play out. So I keep watching more and more of it. And often before I know it, I've stayed up much later into the evening than I ever intended to. Now I do like to have a cup of coffee in the morning to start my day, and that certainly does help to perk me up and get the day started. But even with the stimulation of coffee, if I allow myself to stay up too late for a few days in a row, I notice that I really begin to start dragging. I find myself with a fatigue that I don't really enjoy, and I notice a lack of sharpness that leaves me wondering if I'm really offering my best to the various tasks at hand. I would suspect that I am probably not alone in doing this to myself. Perhaps you've stayed up too late watching a show, or perhaps you've not stayed up too late watching a show, but I think that we all have ways of pushing ourselves too far from time to time. Sometimes we overfill our schedules to the point that there's barely even room to breathe. We run from one thing to another until we're on the brink of exhaustion. Sometimes we work ourselves to the bone until we're just a frayed and frazzled mess. Sometimes we keep aggravating an injury because we cannot bear the thought of being still. We know we're tired, stressed, bruised, and battered, and yet we fear the disastrous results sure to come about if we were to stop. So we keep pressing on. We make an extra cup of coffee, or we buy an energy drink to manufacture a bit of energy. We find ways to cut corners to help us keep up the crazy schedules. We use medicine to cover the pain so that we can keep pressing on as if our bodies were 25 forever. We all have times where we get ourselves into cycles and patterns that we know are not the best, habits that we can feel wearing us down. And yet, we also know what it is like to simply feel stuck in these habits and patterns, and to think that we have no other option than to just keep pressing on, hoping that eventually the same actions will lead to different conclusions. But we all know where these paths lead, don't we? If I stay up too late over and over again, eventually I will lose my sharpness. I will be perpetually deflated, and I will not be able to engage the Word of God with much wisdom or insight at all. When we keep our schedules overly stuffed, we tend to wind up in patterns of poor nutrition, and we give little attention to those around us because we're just too stressed trying to make it to everything on time. When we become workaholics, we often neglect those closest to us, and we often push ourselves until we either hit a wall or we're overtaken by anxiety. When we refuse to listen to the signs and signals of our bodies, we regularly wind up with major procedures and lifelong limitations. There is certainly something to be said about things like perseverance and endurance, but we human beings are such creatures of extremes, and once we get going in a certain rut, we're very good at going and going and going, and ignoring every red flag and caution sign along the way. This is why I find today's gospel so especially refreshing. So often as we approach the scriptures, we do so for guidance with how we're supposed to do something. How do we talk about God? How do we live as faithful Christians? How do we minister well? How do we care for the poor with charity and compassion? How do we navigate life as the body of Christ? But as we give our attention to today's gospel, we see that the busy activity has already happened. The doing is already done. And it's been a lot of activity. The disciples have been sent out two by two to cast out demons, to heal the sick, to proclaim the gospel.
They have traveled all around and they've shared all kinds of ministries and experiences. On top of all of that, they've recently learned that John the Baptist has been killed. The disciples have just expended quite a bit of physical, mental, and emotional energy as they have obeyed the commands of Christ. Many towns have been traveled to on foot. Some have been welcoming of the disciples while others rejected them. People have been healed of their ailments. The works of the devil have been thwarted. The gospel has been proclaimed, and a friend in the ministry has been murdered. As the disciples regather around their master in the gospel today, they have been through a lot, and they're beginning to get a lot of attention so that even as they've come back from their labors, people continue to pursue and seek out and surround them. People who want to be healed, helped, encouraged, and taught. People who wish to understand the kingdom of God and know the hope of life and redemption. How would we respond to such a crowd? Often we would try to keep on going, wouldn't we? We've been doing important work. The people still need us, so we can't stop now. Dig deep, keep going. That's often what we do, isn't it? But Jesus doesn't let that happen. He knows his disciples are exhausted. He knows that they've not had anything to eat. He knows that continuing to push them will not result in the good that anyone desires. So Jesus makes a choice in our gospel today. And he makes a hard choice. He brings everything to a halt. His disciples need to rest, and they need to step out of the frenzy. So Jesus has them get into a boat and head towards the other side of the lake. They go to a quiet place. Even though the crowds are tracking them and rushing around the lake to try and meet them on the other side, while they're in the boat together, all the hustle and bustle settles down and they're finally able to take some time and rest. They likely are able to take some nourishment and they're able to enjoy some time alone with Jesus, where nothing else is able to barge in and interfere. In some ways, the disciples' time in the boat is much like our worship in church each week. The name of the space that you're in is actually the nave, which comes from the Latin word navis, for boat or ship. But in this place, we step out of the crowds and the chaos for some moments of focused rest with our God. Here he is with us. He gives himself to us. He teaches us and consoles us. And he prepares us for when the busyness will commence on the other side of the lake. Today's gospel has much to teach us then. None of us does anything that's more important than what the disciples were doing. And yet even with the importance of their ministry, and even with the great need that all that their ministry could offer, they still needed to take a break. They still needed rest and nourishment. And that rest and nourishment, it didn't come about unless someone interfered. We too have limits. We too need times of rest and refreshment. And we too often need to be able to make the hard choice to step out of the whirlwind of life. Rest is important, but it doesn't happen on its own. We must intentionally value and make time for it. The gospel also shows that it is important that as important as the work is that the disciples are doing, the world doesn't come crashing down when they take a break. We so often feel so caught up in the demands of life to the point that we're genuinely afraid of what would happen if we stopped things even for a minute. And yet, this time of peace in the boat with Jesus will actually lead into the greatest feeding miracle ever known. But you'll have to come back next Sunday for that one. And finally, this gospel shows us the great care that Christ has for us. Our God genuinely and truly does love and care for us, and he's not ordering us around so that he can take advantage of us and use us. But Christ really does live and act and teach for our ultimate good and benefit. And sometimes Jesus will call us to things that don't immediately make sense. He wants us to take a break when we still see so much needing to be done. But when we listen, we always see that he was right in the end. He knew us better than we knew ourselves. And his commands were actually invitations to greater life and wellness and joy. So this summer, may we take time to reflect on our own lives. What are the frenzies that we've gotten ourselves trapped in? What are the fears that have prevented us from taking care of ourselves? Have we spent much time in the boat with Jesus lately? And may we also ponder the goodness of the God that we worship, the God who cares so deeply for us and who teaches and guides us, so that our hope might not be just for some heavenly future, but that we might live healthy lives of faith, ministry, and love, even today. Amen. Friends, at this time we rise and we join in making profession of the faith that we share. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
We pray for Christ's holy church, for the nations of the world, and for the needs of our brothers and sisters throughout creation. For Christ's holy church, that our proclamation of the gospel might be faithful and true, and that through the administration of the sacraments, the whole world might hear of and encounter Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all bishops, pastors, chaplains, deacons, seminarians, teachers, and parents, that they may nurture the faith that God has given them and serve faithfully all whom God has placed in their care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all who hold positions of authority, that they might work with diligence and integrity, and that their efforts might work towards the good of all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all who are stressed, anxious, tired, hurting, and feeling stuck, that they may know the care of Christ for them, that they may have courage to care for themselves, and that they may draw close to Christ and find rest in him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those who are homeless and poor, those who are enduring hardship, and those who are victims of disasters, that they might be protected and cared for, and that the hearts of others might be moved to offer care and compassion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all who are sick or battling limitations, that they might find healing in their bodies and spirits, and that caregivers and friends might come to their aid. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all who have died, that Christ might hold fast to them, that they may be at peace, and that the works and promises of God might serve to gently wipe away the tears of those who weep. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the saints of the church, especially we remember St. James and St. Mary Magdalene, may their devotion to Christ and their sacrifice for the sake of the gospel teach and inspire us to live lives of faith, service, and obedience to Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Take a moment to share that peace. Thank you.
us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts towards those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Almighty and merciful God, you are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world, to fulfill for us your holy will, and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. And we ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, we may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all of your saints. For to you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever.
Amen. Come, your will be done on earth.
in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Receive you.
But only speak the word, and I shall be healed.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Thank you. Friends, we rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us and keep us in his grace unto everlasting life.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift, in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you, being gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you.
Trinity Lutheran Church. It is a joy to be together on this beautiful ninth Sunday after Pentecost. Just a few announcements before we depart. This coming Monday, we have our next round of committee meetings starting at 6 p.m. with our worship, and then with our outreach ministry meeting at 7 at Trinity Hall. Thursday, we have the Women of Trinity planning meeting at 4 p.m., anyone know where that is? I didn't write that down.
That'll be in Trinity Hall.
Saturday, we have the young adult gathering at the River House. I think that's at 2 p.m. I didn't write that in my thing, but yes, it's at 2. If you look at our beautiful bulletins today, you'll notice, well, you probably won't notice they're different, but Pastor David and I had quite a fun time stapling and folding them together because our
wonderfully talented administrative assistant, Stacy, is away on vacation until this coming Wednesday. So if there's anything you need from her, I hope it can wait till then. For all other inquiries, please look down at the sign-up sheet in Trinity Hall. And are there any other announcements before we depart today? Well then, go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.